Thank you so much for the invitation to speak here, and I hope you can all understand me well. And yes, so it's K-motives and causal duality, and I will start the talk with some unnecessarily complicated point of view on algebraic tori, yeah? So this will perhaps get more complicated and more interesting later on, but I want to start with tori. So let's say I have some split algebraic torus T. So this is just something isomorphic to copies of the multiplicative group. Then to such a torus, I can associate a dual torus. And this will be isomorphic. The torus and the dual torus are isomorphic, but not canonically isomorphic. But what you can do with a torus and its dual is the following natural identification. Namely, you can look at the character lattice of the torus. So this is homomorphisms from the torus to the multiplicative group, which is some free abelian group, the character lattice. And you can look at the co-character lattice of the dual torus. So these are homomorphisms from the multiplicative groups into the torus. And those two abelian groups are actually naturally identifiable. And we will just say they are the same thing. So this is what makes a torus and a dual torus special, yeah? This identification. Okay, and now I want to complicate this unnecessarily. So let's first say that R is the group algebra of this character lattice, or equivalently the co-character lattice, and we will do everything with rational coefficients. And now there are two points of view on this R. So one thing you could do is you could look at this dual torus and look at the complex points. So this is a topological space. And you can look at the fundamental group of this thing. And this is actually the same as the co-character lattice. So this ring is the group algebra of the fundamental group of this dual torus. Another point of view is the following. So let's look at the character lattice of my torus. So the character lattice gives me all the one-dimensional representations of this torus. And then all representations split into direct sum of those one-dimensional representations. Hence, when I look at the group algebra of this character lattice, this will be the same as the K-theory of the category of representations of this torus, yeah, or the representation ring of the torus. Or to make this even, to write this even more complicated way, is you could say this is the T-equivariant algebraic K-theory of a point. Yeah, because vector bundles on points are just representations of the torus. Okay, and now everything is rationalized. If I don't put the Q, just imagine the Q. Okay, so in fact, the T-equivariant algebraic K-theory of a torus is naturally the same thing as the group algebra of the dual torus. Yeah, and now let's make this into a categorical statement. So I could look at the derived categories of R modules, finitely generated R modules. And now this has two geometric interpretations, this category. One is, this is the same as local systems, let's say whose stalks are finitely generated under the fundamental group on the dual torus. This is one point of view. But there's also another geometric point of view which goes in the direction of K-theory. Namely, this category, derived category of R modules, is also the same thing as the category of constant T-equivariant K-motives on a point. Okay? So probably the right-hand side with the locally constant sheaves is the most familiar thing, and the constant K-motives is something which is not so very familiar, because this is quite new thing to be able to talk about T equivariant K motives. So in my talk today, I will explain what K motives are and hopefully motivate you to interest you for K motives, because I think they are extremely natural thing. And also I will generalize everything from the torus on this slide, which is kind of more or less trivial, to a general reductive group. Okay, so let's start doing this generalization. And yeah, so I want to start with K-motives. So I think the easiest way to think about K-motives is to think in an analogy. So the analogy is the following. So constructible sheaves are to singular cohomology what K-motives are to algebraic K-theory. And I think if you understand this analogy, or if you think about this analogy, then K-motives are extremely natural. So what do I mean by this? Let's make this more precise, this analogy. So first of all, to every variety X, I can associate a triangulated category of K-motives. So in the analogy with constructible sheaves, this would be the derived category of constructible sheaves on the complex points of C. This would be the analogy. But now it's not this, but K-motives. Yeah? So this is triangulated category of K-motives. And now this is not just a category on its own, but actually for every morphism between varieties, you get interesting functors. And in fact, one gets a six-functor formalism extremely similar to the six-functor formalism for constructible sheaves. So to morphism F, you can associate inverse image functor, direct image functor, the exceptional versions thereof, tensor, there's a tensor product and internal HOM for K-motives. And this is mostly due to Sierzynski and de Glis and their huge book on triangulated categories of mixed motives. Yes, triangulated category of mixed motive and the thesis of Joseph Ayoub, whose name I forgot, it's something in French. Okay, and also very importantly for us, there is now an equivariant version of this whole formalism. So also, I mean, you know, there are equivariant sheaves on topological spaces. Now you also have equivariant K-motives. So here I want to say a few words. This doesn't work completely general yet, but as long as it's tori or linearly reductive groups, then everything is fine. Yeah, so since we will only work with torus equivariant stuff, this will be enough for us. And this equivariant stuff is due to Marc Heuwa, who defined a equivariant stable motivic homotopy category. And that's basically the starting point to define such a formalism of motives. Okay, good. And now to make this analogy even more striking with the constructible sheaves, so if you compute HOM groups in the category of K-motives, then the HOM groups are actually given by algebraic K-theory. Yeah. So if you compare this HOM group between Q and Qn, so Q is the tensor unit, if you would do this with constructible sheaves, on the right-hand side, you would get singular cohomology. And now we don't get this, but we rather get K-theory or equivariant K-theory. Yeah. Okay, and this is, by equivariant K-theory, I really mean the K-theory of the category of equivariant sheaves, yeah. Okay, good. So, yeah. So now I want to explain to you something which I think is very could be interesting. Namely, let's try and define all the stuff we could do for constructible sheaves, but now let's do it for K-motives instead. So let's try and define something like intersection K-theory complexes using this category. Yeah? So for constructible sheaves, you can define intersection cohomology complexes, and let's try to do analogous thing now. So first of all, I want to start with constant K-motives. So a constant K-motive is just an element of the triangulated category generated by the tensor unit. Yeah, so this is what I want to call a constant K-motive. So I have this triangulated category of constant K-motives. And for example, if I compute if I want to understand what the category of T equivariant constant K-motives on a point is, and by point I mean spec FP bar, that's important, then actually this has a very simple description. This is just a derived category, bounded derived category of finitely generated R modules, where R is this representation ring as before. And this is simply follows by computing the K-theory, because this category computes K-theory. Good. So that's the first thing. Now, okay, let's not only look at constant stuff, but let's say our variety is has a stratification, meaning it can be written as a disjoint union of locally closed subvarieties. And let's also assume that those subvarieties are all just affine spaces, yeah, to not make it too complicated. And also this applies to flag varieties, for example, so it will be enough for all our applications. And also there needs to be some assumption on the stratification, which I won't explain, yeah, but let's just hope that it will be fulfilled in all the examples I consider later on. Yeah, good. And then I can define a category of K-motives which are locally constant along the stratification. Yeah, so if I restrict this K-motive, which I can do because I have six functors to a stratum, this should be constant. Okay, and then you can prove the following theorems. First thing is that the K-motives, or those certain K-motives, have a notion of weight. So by weight, I mean something like weight in the sense of Hodge structures, or weight in the sense of Eladic cohomology. Yeah? So there's a very similar notion for weight, but for K-motives under this, those assumptions. Yeah? And this means you can define weight zero, or in other words, pure K-motives. Good. Okay. So, and now if you think about the intersection cohomology, so if you look at Eladic sheaves and then you look at, we do everything with the characteristic zero coefficients, and then you look at the stuff which is pure of weight zero, this decomposes into direct sum of intersection cohomology complexes. Yeah, so in fact, this is an analogy. Yeah, I mean, in fact, you could think of the pure K-motives as an analogy to direct sums of intersection cohomology complexes. Or if you want, in characteristic P, this wouldn't work so nicely, maybe if you don't have decomposition theorem, then this would be rather be something like parity sheaves. So those pure K-motives are analogous, K-theoretic analogs to intersection cohomology complexes of parity sheaves. Yeah, and that's why you could maybe call them intersection K-theory complexes. Good. And then another thing you can prove, which is maybe a little bit different from the usual world, is that actually there's an equivalence between the category of K-motives, all of those K-motives, and the homotopy category of pure K-motives. And this is using some formalism of Bondaco, and this is called a weight complex functor. So if you have some weight structure or notion of weight on a category, you can take an object and chop it up into pure of weight zero things. And this is what this functor does. And then it gives you even a complex in this homotopy category. And in fact, this is an equivalence. Yeah. So maybe if you know the category of mixed sheaves as defined by Achar and Rich, they define their mixed category of sheaves as the homotopy category of parity sheaves, basically. Yeah. And so here, this is similar. But actually, this mixed thing would be the same as the original thing. Yeah. Okay. So far for so much for this. So now let's talk about some applications to reductive groups. And for this, I want to talk about Kojoule duality in the sense of Balanchine, Ginzburg, and Zirkle. Kojoule duality for reductive groups. So let's say I have a not only a torus, but the torus sits inside of some bigger group, maybe, yeah, which is reductive, and this torus is a maximal torus inside of this reductive group. Then my duality for tori generalizes to a duality also for the reductive groups, meaning there's also a dual of my reductive group, the Langlands dual of my reductive group. Yeah? And if you want to really do it, you compute the root datum and you just swap the root datum around. Okay, good. So now let's talk about the Kojoule duality. So I want to talk about it in completely geometric terms, because I will also later talk about Kojoule duality and K-motives in geometric terms. So first, this notation here means the D is for a derived category of constructible sheaves. And then I always mean that you look at the complex points of those spaces. So G mod B is a flag variety. And then on the left-hand side, oh, yeah, This would be a category of constructible sheaves on the flag variety. But if you restrict to any stratum, this should be constant, yeah, and also bounded and so on. So this would be this category. Constant along the Brüha cells of the flag variety. Okay, and now there's some duality between this category and the same category which you can associate to the Langlands dual situation. But actually, it is not really between the categories of constructible sheaves, but you have to upgrade them. Yeah, you have to look at mixed sheaves instead. So this is an upgrade of the usual category of sheaves, which has some kind of additional grading, meaning there's a notion of Tate twist, which is like a shift of grading functor, and it's a graded version of constructible sheaves. And then this Kujul duality is really would really be an equivalence of category between those two situations. Okay, and for the representation, for a more representation theoretic view, and what's also the view which is maybe more in the more No, I don't know. More representation theoretic view would be that this category of mixed sheaves would just be the same as the bounded derived category of the graded category O of the Lie algebra. Yeah, okay. So this Kujul duality sends IC complexes to perverse tilting sheaves. And also what will be more most interesting for us from the intuition is that it interchanges the Tay twist and the shift twist. So it doesn't commute with the Tay twist, but rather it does this weird thing that Kujul duality exchanges the Tay twist with the shift twist in this direction. Okay. And also I want to emphasize that all of those statements are not true without the mix. Okay, so you need to pass to this graded world. Okay, so far for the Kujul duality. And now the next goal will be to get rid of the mix and to see if there's also an ungraded geometric version of Kujul duality. And for this, this we'll do on the next slide. So let's put this Kujul duality again here, the usual Kujul duality here again, and let's try to get rid of the mix. There's one very easy way to get rid of the mix, namely from this mixed sheaves, however you define them. In this case, there's a realization functor, which just goes from this mixed world into the just usual constructible sheaves. Okay, so this is possible to get rid of this mixed. And let me see. Okay, exactly. The realization functor, it forgets about the Tay twist. Yeah, if you Tay twisted before, that's basically doing nothing in the just usual world of constructible sheaves. So now we also want to forget the grading on the left-hand side, But here the problem is that Kujul duality interchanges the Tay twist with the shift twist. So if you want to forget the grading on the left-hand side, we need to, and make a commutative diagram like this, we need to construct some functor and some category which forgets about the shift twist instead about the Tay twist. And that's not true for constructible sheaves. They can't see the Tay twist, but if you shift, then you shift also for constructible sheaves. Yeah. Okay. And of course, this is where K-motives come into play. So K-motives are exactly the thing you need to look at if you want to forget about the shift twist instead of the Tay twist. So why should this be true? This is already happens when you look at the P1. Yeah. So if you look at P1, the cohomology of P1 sits in 2 degrees. Yeah, degree 2 and degree 0. But the K-theory of P1 just sits in degree 0. Yeah? So it forgets about the shift twist. This is what you can see with a calculation like this. Okay, so the statement of the theorem would be that there is this commutative, how do you say this, commutative diagram like this, and the bottom row of this is basically an ungraded Cauchy duality. Okay. So, and still on the left-hand side, you can define something like intersection K-theory complexes, and they get mapped to perverse tilting sheaves on the right-hand side. Good. So, and yeah. I don't know, actually. I mean, the talk would be over now, but you talked a little bit in the beginning about the feedback
thing. So you can take a couple more minutes, but try to wrap. You can take a couple more minutes, but try to wrap things up relatively.
No, I will be finished. It's just one more slide. I just wondered because now the official time would be over, but two more minutes.
These things happen.
Okay. Good. So now I just want to show you what the big statement should be, not just this one on the last slide. So if you want to generalize this to also the equivariant setting, then the following thing should happen, namely the category of T equivariant K motifs on the flag variety should actually be Cauchy dual to also some kind of constructible sheaves on the dual side, but now this has to be something in connection with the fundamental group. Yeah. So on the left-hand side, we have a natural action of the ring R, because R is the R acts on everything, on all of those K motifs. And so on the right-hand side, you want something where the fundamental group acts on. And so you take T monodromic sheaves, and then you have to do it on the enhanced flag variety. Yeah, you shouldn't mod out the whole B, but just the unipotent radical. And the Cauchy duality should be between those two categories. And in fact, those two categories should both have a combinatorial description. And now in the usual Cauchy duality, you would have a description in some kind of Zergel bimodules or Zergel modules over the co-invariant algebra or over the symmetric algebra. But now everything should be over R, over this ring R. So there should be a description in terms of K theoretic to Zergel bimodules. So in terms of this ring R. Yeah? And this is theorem and conjecture. So more or less it works. Yeah. So, but yeah. And so on. And that's it for my talk. And I want to say thank you so much. And yeah.
All right. Thank you. Yes, participants can unmute themselves, so people can either raise their hands or just go ahead.
Jens, I have two questions.
Yes.
My first is this functor from the realization functor from the constructible. This mixed category, the one on the left, yeah, that one there on the left side of the slide.
Yeah.
Does that take the IC objects to the IC objects?
Yes, it does. It does, yeah.
And then my other question, which I sort of already asked you once, but what happens if you try to do this version for the Satake category? Like, take this K-theoretic, K-motives for the affine Grassmannian constructible with respect to the Giovo orbits.
So if you do it constructible, it should work, but if you do it equivariantly, the problem is you are just bound to linearly reductive groups. Now this is because of the construction, but the constructible works, yeah, more or less. I hope, yeah.
But yeah. What what do you know anything about the kind of category you get? I mean, well, whether it has a Langlands dual Satake kind of description, or
no.
If it has monoidal structure, or
no,
if it's semi-simple,
no, yeah, that's very good, yeah. No, not yet. The problem is with the monoidal thing. As soon as you have some not a linear reductive group acting, it's problematic. Then this definition, so Marc Coyoir defined those K-motives, and he explained to me that he can just do it for linear reductive groups, and probably he also doesn't know how to do it in general, and I also don't. So, and if he doesn't know, I mean, I won't even try to understand. Yeah, thank you so much.
Yeah, I have a question maybe related to the previous question. So because for if you consider the Sataki category, I think actually we can just focus on, for example, like a Schubert variety, which is sort of like a quotient by a finite type quotient of the L plus G of the positive loop group. So does this possibly sound like you can sort of carry out your construction in the in this?
Yeah, maybe I never tried. I just tried to do everything with black varieties, small black varieties until now. Yeah, yeah, just, maybe. Yeah. I don't know. Yeah, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. I have a naive question. Does this category have a T structure?
No, that's the problem. So the problem is the following. So for K motifs, the following weird stuff happens. So for motifs, you always have two shifts. Yeah. So motivic cohomology is always bigraded. You have the Tay twist and you have the cohomological shift. And for Tate, for K theory, actually something, I mean, not weird, but something happens. Namely, there's some periodicity. If you shift by one and if you Tay twist by one and you shift by two, that's actually the identity. So it's kind of hard to define something like a perverse C structure because the shift is, it's more periodic in this direction. So no, I would say, yeah, rather it's not possible. Yeah. But I think the more natural thing here is to have a weight structure. So weight structure is kind of dual to a T structure. And this works because the shift by one and, tetris by one and shift by two, this keeps the weight the same. So this is compatible with weights. And so you have weight structure on this kind of categories. Yeah. Yeah.
Great. Thanks.
Thank you so much.
Can I ask? So if we consider the category of constructible shifts on G, which are equivariant for B on the right, but B on the left with the permutation. So the subset of B times B, which corresponding to permutation. Does it correspond to something in your picture?
Oh, I don't know. I never saw this construction. Sorry, I don't know, but interesting. Yeah. No, I'm sorry.
Maybe it has a name, but I just don't know how to say it properly.
No. Okay. No, I've never seen it. Yeah. No, I don't know. Yeah. Thank you.
May I also ask a question? That's a follow-up of Sam's, I guess.
Uh-huh.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
Yeah. So you said that there's no T structure on the K motifs on the left bottom.
Yeah.
But yes, on the right bottom, you do have a T structure.
Oh,
right?
Yes.
So you even have two or maybe more. So do you know what do they correspond to on the other side? Or what is, for example, the shift? Because you said that there's some periodicity on the K motif part. But the usual shift from the right-hand side should go to something on the left-hand side. Is it the usual shift or what is it? Or could you transform?
The equivalences are, all the functors here are triangulated. So the shift on the right-hand side corresponds to the shift on the left. Side. That's true. And also you're completely right. It's through this equivalence, you have a T structure on this category. I just wanted to say there's not an easy natural. Okay. Sorry. Also you can define whatever T structure you want on the left hand side. Yes. Because the left hand side is because of the stratification and the gluing, you can also define the T structure on the left hand side because on all the strata, it's just the derived category of R modules. So you can actually look at all kinds of T structure on the left hand side. Maybe, I just wanted to say that I think the more natural thing on the left-hand side is a weight structure than a T structure. Still with the gluing, you are free to do whatever you want. Yeah. I didn't want to doubt this. Yeah.
But do these K motifs look Are they constructed from coherent sheaves on Gmod B in some way, or there's nothing to do with it?
No, not in this case, but rather, so to actually work with those K-motifs, you can actually work in the same way. No, they're not constructed like this. The construction of the category of K-motifs is very complicated, but luckily through the six-functor formalism, you never need to look at the construction. So to construct them, there's something called the stable motivic stable homotopy category. And in this thing, you have a spectrum which represents K-theory. A ring spectrum. So you can look at modules over this thing. So this is just a by force constructs something which has all the properties one wants. Namely, you have six functors, which is given in this from the stable homotopy category, and you have that the hom groups actually compute K theory. Yeah. So the construction is very complicated and not, you can't really work with the construction itself. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.